hundene jo på EU, men de er tørt av ikke sin annen. Og sett om de er bare vilje, og gjør det kan opp på. Alt er nødt til det. Nå er det litt på EU. De er nødt til det som er det. Jeg kan jo bare det. Det er tøyt der. Til en gang, jeg vet jo noe. This has led to a mammoth effort by FEMA and the agencies of our government to try and get folks to think about what would I do if I were in the midst of one of these meteorological disasters. There's a great website that's been set up by FEMA. It's called ready.gov. Go to it, check it out, and give it a little bit of thought. Doesn't take a lot of time.
Of GPS, the global public square. Welcome to all of you in the United States and around the world. I'm Fareed Zakaria, coming to you live from Paris. Today on the show, a global exclusive, an interview with the President of France, Emmanuel Macron, from his office in the Elysee Palace. Macron has spent the week traversing parts of his nation to commemorate the 100th anniversary of the end of World War I. He's gathered scores of world leaders, including President Donald Trump, to pay tribute with him. How long did the war have his relationship to Trump? On the great war and whether today there is also a day.
No, it's so dramatic. I know, but it's funny.
How he's fighting it at Howard McGraw. About his bold plan to make France great again. But first, here's my take. When confronting bad news these days, many of us tend to assume that it's just a bump on the road and things will work out. President Obama was fond of invoking the famous quote, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice." It could be wrong in assuming that in spite of some backsliding here, an election there, progress is inexorable. Well, today behind me at the Arc de Triomphe, world leaders commemorated the end of the largest and bloodiest conflict the world had ever seen. World War I marked a turning point in human history. The end of four massive empires, the rise of Soviet communism, the entry of the United States into global power politics.
The significant
intellectual legacy of
the
idea of inevitable progress. You see, in 1914, before the war began,
the
defined by heavy economic growth, technological revolution, and increasing globalization. It was widely believed that ugly trend lines, when they appeared, were temporary, to be overwhelmed by the onward march of progress. In 1909, Roman Angel wrote a book explaining that war between the major powers was now so costly as to be unimaginable. The Great Illusion became an international bestseller, and just a few years later, a generation of Europeans was destroyed in the carnage of World War I. Could we be similar to complacent today? Well, there are serious statesmen who believe so.
In an address in Parliament,
Emmanuel Macron said, "I don't want to belong to a
generation of people who have forgotten the past." As the statesman of 1914, his statesmen of 1914
started to fall without ever realizing the magnitude of the dangers of their isolated, incremental decisions and non-decisions. Now, Kozhotsky talking. He has organized a Paris peace forum of more than 60 world leaders, which began today to try to combat the dangers of rising nationalism and eroding global cooperation. Are these dangers so real and pressing? What if you compare the world today, it feels less like the 1930s than the 1920s. Economic growth and technological progress were accelerating then as now. We are also seeing a surge in nationalism and the breakdown of cooperation, which were the hallmarks of the 1920s. New great powers were ascending as they are now. Democracies were under strain from demagogues, such as in Italy, where Mussolini destroyed liberal institutions and established control in the 1920s. And in the storm, this was racism and anti-Semitism, which were used to divide countries and exclude various minorities as outside of the real nation. Of course, because of these pressures in the 1920s, we've got the 1930s. The historian David Simon makes a distinction in his new book, The Road.